Mutimarandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chaksurunmilitanyena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadhamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yata Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajevam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishaka Nitamscha He Krishna Karana Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namastate Dapta Kanchana Gorange Radhe Vrindavanishwari Vrishabhanu Stute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakaupatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadhadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare 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 Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare So taking part in this Braja, this Gauramandal Parikrama is an opportunity for us to meditate more on Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his different pastimes. Of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was, during his manifest pastimes, he spent the first half of his manifest period here in Navadvip Dham, which means up to the age of 24 he was residing here in Navadvip. But for the first part of his life he was portraying his scholarly pastimes. He was in the mood of a great scholar, debating with everyone and arguing, defeating them, and then defeating his own arguments and then re-establishing another conclusion. In this way he was appearing to be like a proud scholar, like a great jnani. And of course he was the greatest scholar of his time. He defeated Keshava Kashmiri, who was Digvijay. He had gone everywhere conquering people in debates, and he had come, Keshava Kashmiri had come here to Navadvip, and he happened to meet with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who was at that time still known as Nimai Pandit. And in the course of their meeting there was discussion, and Lord Chaitanya requested this Keshava Kashmiri to compose some verses glorifying Mother Ganges. And Keshava Kashmiri did it immediately, spontaneously, composing verse after verse, all glorifying Mother Ganges. And Nimai Pandit patiently listened to Keshava Kashmiri narrate all of these different verses. And when he finally finished, which was after some considerable time, then Lord Chaitanya, or Nimai Pandit, revealed to Keshava Kashmiri that, oh yeah, your poetry is very nice, you must be not different from Brihaspati, you're so learned, your verses are so scholarly, full of Sanskrit examples, Sanskrit rhetoric and similes, but within your beautiful verses there are some mistakes. And this was a great insult to Keshava Kashmiri, to hear that there could be any fault in his poetry. And he challenged Nimai Pandit, how dare you say there is any fault in my verses? Where is the fault? And then Nimai Pandit recited one of the verses which he had spoken, and then pointed out the different defects which were there within the verse. So Nimai Pandit, in this way, he'd ridiculed the scholastic achievement of Keshava Kashmiri. And his own students were laughing at Keshava Kashmiri. They were laughing at him that he'd been defeated by Nimai Pandit, who was still a teenage young man. He was about 18 years old at the time. But Nimai Pandit rebuked his students and told them, no, don't laugh. It's not nice. He's a great scholar. There are some faults in his verses, but there's no reason for you to laugh at him. So in this way, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was guiding his students that they should behave properly, morally, give proper respect to everyone. Of course, Keshava Kashmiri was a great devotee of Mother Saraswati, the goddess of learning. And that night, Keshava Kashmiri prayed to Mother Saraswati that, have I done something wrong? Have I committed some offense against you that I had to be defeated by this young boy? And Mother Saraswati then revealed to Keshava Kashmiri that he is no ordinary young boy. He's not just any young scholar, but actually he is my Lord and Master. He is the Lord and Master of Mother Saraswati herself. So when Keshava Kashmiri heard this, then he understood more the identity of Nimai Pandit. And the next day he came and he surrendered to Nimai Pandit. Of course, later on, Keshava Kashmiri went off and he did not preach in the line of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He went off and began preaching in one other line. But it is the nature of Lord Chaitanya's pastimes that by his preaching he defeated all of the other different lines of disciplic succession, including, of course, most important, he defeated the Mayavadis. Of course, that he did in Benares when he met with Prakashananda Saraswati. That he converted the Mayavadi sannyasis into Vaishnavas. That after hearing from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu the proper understanding of Vedanta Sutra, then the Mayavadi sannyasis also became Vaishnavas, and they also began to chant the holy name of Krishna. Previously, these Mayavadi sannyasis were very careful never to say the They would never utter the word Krishna or any of the names of the Supreme Lord. They would say names like Brahman. They would speak of Paramatma. They would speak of the Supreme and the Absolute. But they would never speak of the personal names of the Lord like Rama and Krishna or even Vishnu. But after meeting with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then he changed their minds. In a very polite way, he defeated them and converted them to Vaishnavism. So this was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's expertise in preaching, that he could very politely change the minds of the opposition and help them to accept his teaching. When he was in Sri Rangam, he stayed in the home of the Sri Vaishnavas, and there he discussed with Balabhabhata, one of the pujaris in the Sri Rangam temple, and he asked him, why do you worship Lakshmi and Vishnu? Because Mother, you should know that Mother Lakshmi, she also desires to take part in Krishna's pastimes. Mother Lakshmi is usually worshipped by ordinary people to get her blessings. People would like to receive benedictions from Lakshmi. Have well, let me have wealth. Usually that's what most people want in the material world. Money. They're thinking, if I have money, all my problems are solved. And so generally people are very fond to worship the goddess of fortune, Lakshmi. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu pointed out that Mother Lakshmi, the goddess of fortune, she goes to Vrindavan and performs austerities. And the purpose of her performing austerities is to get qualification to enter into Krishna's pastimes. Usually when we see portraits of Mother Lakshmi, her hand is open, indicating that she's giving blessing. But in Vrindavan, the Vrijvasi people, they see Mother Lakshmi with her arms in a prayerful position. She's asking for blessings. She's praying to the Brijbasis, please bless me that I can also understand Krishna's pastimes. Actually, Mother Lakshmi desired to take part in Krishna's Rasa Leela. But Lord Krishna revealed to her that that is not her position. She is the goddess of fortune, and she's meant to be the consort of Lord Narayan. Generally, we see Mother Lakshmi massaging the lotus feet of Lord Narayan, or appearing at his chest. So Mother Lakshmi is the goddess of fortune. It means she's used to opulence. But the gopis who take part in Rasa Leela, they're not opulent. They have a different mood. They enjoy the sweetness of the Lord. In order for anyone to take part in Rasa Leela, they have to develop the mood of the gopis. And the gopis are all in that mood of madhurya, sweetness. They are not interested in opulence at all. They simply want to enjoy the sweet, loving dealings in their exchanges with Lord Krishna. So, to take part in Rasa Leela, you have to become a gopi. But for a queen, the goddess of fortune, the queen of all queens, how can she ever become a gopi? Picking up cow dung, making it into patties every day. As we're seeing also in the Parikrama here in Mayapur, in Navadvip Dham, how the village ladies, how they take care of their cows and they collect the dung, and that provides the fuel for their cooking. And so village people are accustomed to do this kind of work. They don't think anything about it. They grow up in that kind of environment. But the goddess of fortune, she is not from that kind of environment. She's not a village woman. She's not a cowherd woman. So for her to take up that mood, that's practically impossible. Therefore, Lord Krishna explained to Lakshmi that you have to be satisfied with your position as a servant, as a consort of Lord Narayan in the Vaikuntha world. In the Vaikuntha world, we were hearing today, 2.5 rasas are there, right? Shanta and Dasya, and a little bit of friendship. Not friendship like the cowherd boys enjoy with Krishna, but friendship like Uddhava. Uddhava is the friend of Krishna, but he is very careful never to sit on the same level as Krishna. Or Krishna also has friends like Daruka, his chariot driver. Well, we could say Daruka is more servant than friend. But certainly Uddhava, Arjuna is a more intimate friend of Krishna, because Arjuna can lay on the same bed as Krishna. They will eat their meals together. And sometimes even Arjuna will joke with Krishna and tease him, as we see in the Bhagavad Gita, where Arjuna said, "Hey Krishna, hey Yadava, hey Saketi," that Arjuna said that in the past I addressed you as Krishna. I should have given you proper respect and said, "My dear Lord Krishna." But I was thinking of you in a more intimate way. I simply addressed you as Krishna. Or, "Hey Yadava," I called you Yadava. But that was like humiliating you, because you're much more than just Yadava. And "Hey Saketi," that although you're just, you know, from a cowherd family and we don't really know your background so well, is not so good, but I'll allow you to be my friend. I will be compassionate on you and call you my friend. So I addressed you in these ways, jokingly. Now I can realize my offenses. So this was the 11th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, where Lord Krishna had revealed the universal form to Arjuna. Seeing that universal form, then Arjuna was fully convinced of the position of Lord Krishna, and he then confessed his offenses and requested Krishna to please forgive him for his offenses, that he acted in the improper manner, not knowing the actual position of Lord Krishna. He had witnessed Krishna had appeared and then ran off, and he was in that mood of separation from Krishna, that where is Krishna? Where is Krishna? So he, after coming to Kanainatsala and having this experience with Lord Krishna, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu then came back to Navadvip, back to his home in Mayapur. But he was a different person. He had totally changed. The people who knew him were surprised. That, is this the same Nimai Pandit? Is this the same proud scholar, the same arrogant young man who used to argue with us? Now he's a very different person. The different friends which he had, they came to meet him when he came back from Gaya, and Lord Chaitanya was describing to them the glories of Gaya. But when he mentioned Gaya as being Pada Padma, because in Gaya there is the lotus footprint of Lord Vishnu. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu mentioned about the Pada Padma, the lotus footprint which is there in Gaya, then his bhava, his ecstasy of love of Krishna was awakened, and then he began to exhibit transcendental symptoms. And those people who knew him, they were astonished, they were very surprised, that what is this? Chaitanya, Nimai Pandit, he has become a devotee. Previously, they were always thinking, if only this Nimai Pandit could become a devotee. You know, just like we as devotees, we preach to people, maybe we have friends, maybe they're very scholarly, or they're very educated, or they're very aristocratic, and we think, oh, if only they would become a devotee, they could do so much nice service, they could make such a wonderful contribution to our movement. So the devotees in Mayapur were also thinking like that about Nimai Pandit, that his mother and father are both very pure souls, they're from very good families. If only their son Nimai Pandit would become a devotee. But he's so proud, he's a big scholar, he always argues with us, he likes to humiliate us. And they would avoid him. But after he came back from Gaya, he was totally changed. Sriman Pandit had witnessed the initial display of Bhava, which was aroused. It happened at the home of Suklambar Brahmachari. Sriman Pandit went to pick flowers the next morning after hearing Chaitanya Mahaprabhu describe the glories of Gaya and become ecstatic. He said, but I have a great pain in my heart. I am suffering very much. I want to tell all of you about my suffering. Please meet me. Tomorrow we will meet in the home of Suklambar Brahmachari. After reading about Suklambar Brahmachari in the Chaitanya Bhagavat, I was curious to know, where is this Suklambar Brahmachari's house? Because coming on Parikrama, I'd never heard about it. In fact, you know, we don't go there. But I asked the devotees and they told me that, yeah, there is no place. But it's known to be within Antardweep, not very far away from the Yogapith, that his home was there. But we have not erected any shrine there. There's no marking, there's no indication. We hope in the future there will be, because it's another very significant pastime of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that some of his intimate associates like Gadarhar and Srivas Pandit and Sriman Pandit, they all went the next morning to Suklambar Brahmachari's home. Sriman Pandit first of all went that morning to Srivas Pandit's home, because in Srivas Pandit's garden there was a wonderful tree. There was a Kalpa Briksha tree. This tree was giving unlimited numbers of flowers. No matter how many devotees went there to pick flowers every day, there was always more flowers. It was a wish-fulfilling tree, and it was there in the home of Srivas Pandit. So every morning the devotees would go there and pick flowers for their puja. And at that time Sriman Pandit told Srivas Pandit and Gadarhar that, have you heard the news? Nimai Pandit's come back from Gaya and he's totally changed. He's become a devotee. I witnessed it myself. And you can also witness it. He's going to meet us today. You have to come to Suklambar Brahmachari's home and see for yourself. So that day, the devotees all went there to Suklambar Brahmachari's home. Very simple home. He was a very poor person, Suklambar Brahmachari. Now, Brahmacharis are not rich, you know. They're not supposed to be rich anyway. They're not really Brahmacharis if they're rich, right? So Suklambar would live by begging. Whatever he would beg, that's what he would eat. We may think, oh, that is terrible. You know, in the modern times, we think, oh, very bad. You're just begging. But actually, to live by begging is a very purifying, very wonderful manner in which to maintain one's existence. I remember Srila Prabhupada requesting us that when we had the Gurukula in Dallas, in America, he wanted the students in the Gurukula that they should go with the devotees. They should go out to distribute book. He said, I want them to get the experience of begging, because it humbles us. It helps to take away our false pride, our ego, by going out and presenting ourselves before persons and requesting them to give some donation. So Suklambar Brahmachari was maintaining himself like that. Actually, it's described how Suklambar Brahmachari would sometimes be requested by Lord Chaitanya to cook rice for him. Now Lord Chaitanya knew that Suklambar would not get the best quality rice. Right? You go begging, people will give you the broken rice, the crumbs, you know, the little pieces. They won't give you whole grains, nice polished rice. They'll give you the poorer quality, the worst quality. But Lord Chaitanya understood that this is the most relishable, the most tasty of all rice, because it is obtained by begging. So Lord Chaitanya had, Nimai Pandit, he told the devotees they should gather there in the home of Suklambar Brahmachari. And while they were there, then Lord Chaitanya began to speak about the glories of devotional service. And he began to quote different verses from the scripture glorifying devotional service. But the more he spoke, the more he became ecstatic. The more his bhava awakened, and all of the devotees could see his wonderful love for Krishna. Lord Chaitanya became so ecstatic that he fell on the floor, and the hairs on his body all stood on end. Tears flew from his eyes like a river. The whole ground, everything on the floor of the home of Suklambar Brahmachari became like a pool of water due to the tears coming from the eyes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. All of the devotees were astonished. They had never seen before such ecstatic love for Krishna displayed within the body of any devotee. So they were very happy, of course, to see this. However, this kind of love became a problem for Nimai Pandit. People were not able to understand that this is actually symptoms of ecstatic love for God. Mother Sachi was told by different people, oh, your son, he's got some evil spirit in him. You should give him green coconut water to drink. That will certainly cure him. Someone else said, put oil on his head. That will cure. Mother Sachi tried everything, all the different treatments which people suggested, nothing made any difference. So one day she invited Srivas Pandit to come to his home. When Srivas Pandit came to the home of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and he saw the nature of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said to Mother Sachi, he said, "I wish I had the same disease he has. You say your son is diseased. I say, I wish I had that disease. Because that disease is no ordinary disease. That is ecstatic love for Krishna." When Lord Chaitanya heard Srivas Pandit speak like this to Sachi Mata, then Lord Chaitanya was very pleased. And he told Srivas Pandit, he said, "If you had have said that I was mad, I was going to throw myself in the Ganges. I'm glad to hear that you at least can understand something of my situation." So we went to Vidyanagar, and that is of course the place of the personified Vedas, all the great learned personalities, great sages, the different philosophical systems, they all reside there, the personalities presenting the different philosophical systems, the Saptarshans, logic from Gautama, yoga from Patanjali, and Karma Mimamsa from Jaimini, Vedanta from Vyasadeva, Kapila presents the Sankhya philosophy like this, and then Astabhaka, he is presenting the impersonal Mayavadi philosophy. So all of these great personalities, they all reside there in Vidyanagar. And personified Vedas, they also desire to understand the Supreme Lord. It is described how the personified Vedas, they wanted to understand the personal feature of the Supreme Lord. Because we know Lord Brahma has described that Vedeshu Durlabham, it's very difficult to know Govinda from the Vedas. So the Vedas personified, the Shruti Charas, they have great difficulty to understand the Lord, and they requested, "How can we understand you, your personal feature?" So it was arranged that the Shruti Charas, that they would all become gopis. So therefore among the gopis who took part in Krishna's pastimes, you have different groups. You have some gopis who are the eternally liberated gopis who come specifically for this Rasa Leela. And then there are some who are just being elevated to that position, who are just becoming purified. And then you have also the sages from the Dandakaranya forest, during the pastimes of Lord Ramachandra, the sages were attracted to enjoy a conjugal relationship with Lord Ramachandra. But Lord Ramachandra told them that I have vowed only to have one wife. As we explained in relation to Dameshwar Mahaprabhu, Lord Ramachandra only wanted to take one wife. So he told the sages that in my next incarnation, you should all take birth in Braja, in the family of the cowherd people, and come as gopis. And then you can take part, then we can have conjugal relationship. So among the gopis, you have the Dandakaranya sages, and we have also the personified Vedas. They also take birth as gopis. And as gopis, they're able to understand the personal feature of the Lord and take part in his pastimes. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was supposed to teach logic. He came to Gangadas Pandit after coming back from Gaya, and Gangadas Pandit blessed him and said, "Yes, come tomorrow. All of your students are anxious to hear from you. They don't want to have anybody else teach them, so you please come tomorrow and begin your teaching. But when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came and began teaching, he would explain everything in relation to Krishna. The students would ask him, explain to us the meaning of the different letters of the alphabet. And Nimai Pandit, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, would explain that all of the letters of the alphabet are the breathing of the Supreme Lord. And he would explain each and every letter and how it represents the Supreme Lord. And then the students would ask him, tell us the meaning of Dhatu, the verb root. And Lord Chaitanya would explain that this is also the energy of Lord Narayan. And he would explain everything they asked, he would simply explain about Lord Krishna or Lord Narayan. He did not know anything else. There was no more grammar. There was no more rules of logic. But everything was simply indicating Krishna. And the students were upset. And they were complaining in the beginning. They went to Gangadas Pandit and complained that Nimai Pandit is just teaching us about Krishna. He only wants to teach us Krishna, that everything is Krishna and there's nothing else but Krishna. He's not teaching us anything. We're not learning anything from him. Gangadas Pandit called Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and told him, he said, it's very nice you'll become a devotee, but don't think because you've become a devotee that you have to give up studying. You still have to learn, you still have to teach, you should still continue to teach everything. Please continue to teach the boys properly. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went back and he continued teaching, but still everything was only Krishna. So one afternoon while he was teaching, there was a great Brahmana nearby and he recited a verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam. And he recited a verse from the Srimad Bhagavatam which was spoken by the Yajnapatnis, the wife of the Brahmanas who perform sacrifice. In the 10th canto Srimad Bhagavatam, those of you who read Krishna book and so on, you'll know the Leela, that the cowherd boys were hungry and they went to beg from the Brahmanas. They were performing a sacrifice and they had a lot of foodstuff prepared. But when they went to beg, they wouldn't give anything for them. They ignored them. They didn't pay any attention to them. And the cowherd boys came back and said to Krishna and Balaram, we couldn't get anything. They wouldn't give us anything for our breakfast. We're going hungry today. Krishna told them, you go to their wives. Go and ask the wives of the Brahmanas. So when they went to ask the wives, then the Brahmanas' wives, immediately they came running. Just like I was seeing when we were coming through one village today in the procession, coming through Vijayanagar, I saw there were three ladies. They all came running out of the house. The Sankirtan party was coming by and the deities were coming. And there must have been ladies that were in their house back from the main road. And they heard the kirtan and they just dropped everything. And they came running. And as they were running, one of them, there was a pot of water on the, and she was purifying her hands. And at the same time, she dived. She actually dove. She threw herself on the ground in front of the devotees and the deities offering her obeisances. So much eagerness. It was really a wonderful thing to see, the enthusiasm, the devotion, the eagerness to offer, to just to come and offer obeisances to the deities and to the devotees. So the same thing happened 5,000 years ago with these wives of the Brahmanas. When they heard Krishna and Balaram were nearby and they were hungry, they immediately gathered all of the preparations they prepared for the yajna. And they came and they brought it and offered to Krishna and Balaram. So when they saw Krishna, Then they spoke a beautiful verse. There's a beautiful verse there in the Srimad Bhagavatam which describes the beauty of Krishna, how he's decorated with the peacock feather on his head and beautiful colored blue flowers in his ears and sharp-shaped earrings and, you know, everything, all the beautiful features of Lord Krishna. So that these Brahmana's wives, they describe the beauty of Krishna. And this Brahmana was reciting this verse. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was in the classroom teaching his students. But when he heard this verse, he could not control his emotions. And his ecstatic love awakened. And he just became totally overwhelmed in ecstatic love for Krishna. He rolled on the floor, and again all of the symptoms of ecstatic love were displayed through his body. So when the students saw this, they were just astonished. They could understand this was not ordinary. This was something very special. After several hours, Lord Chaitanya came back to external consciousness. And then he said to the students, he said, "Oh, did I explain everything properly to you today?" And the students said, "Yes, we have understood everything today. You have explained very nicely. Now we understand." But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu could understand something of what has happened, and he said to the boys, he said, I have to give up teaching you. It is not fair that I can no longer teach you what you desire to learn, because I can only teach Krishna. I don't know anything else except Krishna. And if you want to know something else, then I am not the right person to teach you. So you can take another teacher. But the student said, "No, what you are teaching us is right. We also want to know Krishna. We have heard from you, and we are convinced that actually it's Krishna which should be known, and nothing else but Krishna. We also want to know Krishna. Therefore, we are also giving up our studies. We are also packing our bags. We just want to know about Krishna and nothing else." So in this way, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave up his teaching, and he began the kirtan. And every night, they would meet in the home of Srivas Thakur and have kirtan there with all of the devotees. Of course, they would chant all day and all night. Lord Chaitanya didn't like to waste any time. Why spend so many hours sleeping when we can be chanting the holy name? So every evening, there would be kirtan. But these kirtans, in the beginning, these were all private. They were not public programs. Generally in ISKCON, our programs are public. People can come, you know, the doors are open. We're not very restrictive. So long as people don't disturb, anyone can come and sit and listen, take part in the kirtan. But in the time, in the initial time of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's preaching in Mayapur, it was private. It was only for the devotees. There were many others who wanted to come, but they were not allowed. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu liked to have the intimate association of his devotees. We know there's a special mood when you have just people we know who are firm devotees. Where there are outsiders or new people come, then the mood is not the same. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, therefore, liked to be with the devotees. One evening they were having kirtan, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stopped the kirtan and said, "Something is wrong. I'm not feeling the same ecstasy as usual. Is somebody hiding here?" And they looked around, they could not find anyone. So again they started kirtan. But again, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stopped the kirtan and said, "Something is wrong. I'm not feeling any ecstasy tonight. Please look and see if is somebody here who should not be here." So at that time, Srivas Pandit looked very carefully and he found his mother-in-law hiding among the different grains which were stored in his home. And he had her removed. He said, "Take her by the hair and eject her from the house." So although she was the mother-in-law of Srivas Thakur, she was taken out, she was not allowed to be in the home for the kirtan. Of course, then there was another time, there was the brahmachari who only lived on milk and fruit. He was a strict brahmachari. And he only lived on milk and fruit. So he begged Srivas Pandit, please allow me to witness the kirtan. Please allow me. So Srivas Thakur, he's a gentle, simple-minded person. He conceded. He said, all right, we'll hide you. I think it will be okay for you. But again, when the kirtan began, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is omniscient and he could understand somebody is here who should not be here. At that time the brahmachari could hear and he knew that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was conscious of him being present, so he felt guilty and he came out from hiding. He said, I'm sorry, I don't want to disturb your kirtan, but I'm a brahmachari and I only live on milk and fruit. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, "Get out of here." He said, "Do you think you can ever get Krishna just by being a brahmachari and living on milk and fruit? Nobody ever achieved Krishna in that way." So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu corrected this mentality of this foolish brahmachari who thought that simply by living on milk and fruit, simply by doing austerity, that he could get the goal of life. The goal of life is never achieved by these things. But the goal of life is achieved by the mercy of devotees. Through the mercy of the devotees, we can get devotion. And devotion will bring us to love for Krishna. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was regularly coming there to the home of Srivas Pandit and having kirtan, but there were complaints. The neighbors didn't like it. They were also Brahmins, but they were not the Brahmins like Srivas Pandit. We described about Srivas Pandit how he'd gone to hear Devananda Pandit recite Srimad Bhagavatam. He was so eager to hear Srimad Bhagavatam that he had to go and hear Devananda Pandit recite. The other brahmanas were all smarta brahmins. They were attached to ritualistic ceremonies, karmakandi activities. They had no devotion. They were not interested in love for God. They were more interested in kama and artha. So, because of the Srivas Pandit having kirtan in his home every night, it was a disturbance to the Brahmins. And they said, "We cannot get any sleep at night for all of this kirtan every night." We often get this kind of complaint, right? You have a temple, you always have trouble with the neighbors. If you don't have trouble with the neighbors, you're not doing much preaching. It means you're not getting many people coming to your program. You're not doing much kirtan. If you're a sleepy temple, then the neighbors are okay. But where there's a lot of action, festivals, kirtans, programs, many guests, oh, the neighbors, they don't like it. We have so much experience. And Prabhupada also had that experience too. in New York, even in New York in the very beginning. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in the beginning of his movement, 500 years ago, there was opposition. But even the caste brahmanas were against the movement. They didn't like it. Why you have to make so much noise? Why can't you sleep at night? Why can't we get sleep at night? You're disturbing us. Like this, so much complaint. And then they were saying, then they told Shivaji Thakur that the Muslims are coming. The king has heard about your kirtan and he's sending two boatloads of troops to arrest you. So at that time Shiva's Pandit, he's a Vaishnava, he's not really afraid, but he's a simple man. So he was worshipping Lord Nrisingadev and kept the door closed. Usually doors would always be open, but he was afraid the these Muslim soldiers may come and arrest everyone. So he closed the door. And even Lord Chaitanya came to his home. Lord Chaitanya had to kick on the door to get in. Shivas, open up, it's me, I'm coming, I just want to see you. And Lord Chaitanya could understand the thinking of Shivas Pandit, that he was a little afraid that the Muslims may come and arrest everybody. So at that time, then Lord Chaitanya told him, he said, Shivas, don't you know I am that person you're worshipping? I am not different from the super soul, the Lord in the heart. I will never allow these Mohammedans to come and arrest you. If I'm in their heart, how can they ever come and arrest you? So then Lord Chaitanya said, and even if they don't take my direction from the heart, if they do come and arrest you, I will be the first one to go in the boat with you. And I will go before that Qazi and I will tell him, I will pull him down from his seat and I will put him in his position. I will tell him that you're not doing anything wrong. But if I'm not able to do that, then I will challenge the Qazi that you bring your animals here and you bring all the Qazi and ask them to recite their scriptures and make these animals cry. All the cows and donkeys and dogs and birds, make them cry by reading your scripture. And if they cannot do that, then I will do it. I can do that. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in order to prove his power, he said, just watch. And Shiva's Pandit's little niece was there, Narayani, only 4 years old. And Lord Chaitanya said to Shiva's Pandit's little niece, Narayani, cry for Krishna, Narayani. And that little four-year-old girl immediately began to shed tears. And her body trembled in ecstasy as she called out the holy name of Lord Krishna. This little girl, Narayani, is famous among all the Vaishnavas because she received the mercy of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. She would also eat the remnants of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's food. It is said that she eternally eats the remnants of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So that same Narayani later on grew up, she was married, and her son became the last disciple of Lord Nityananda Prabhu. Her son became Vrindavan Das Thakur. Vrindavan Das Thakur is a Vyasadev of Lord Chaitanya's pastimes. Srila Vyasadev describes the pastimes of Lord Krishna, and Vrindavan Das Thakur has given to us the description of the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya in his book, the Chaitanya Bhagavat. So Vrindavan Das Thakur is considered the Vyasadev of Chaitanya Lila. So today we were there at the home of Vrindavan Das Thakur. we'll stop here. It's getting a bit late. Yeah. Tomorrow we will be going on to Belpakor. Tomorrow our camp will be in Belpakor, which is where the deity of Lord Chaitanya's maternal home is. Lord Chaitanya's mother, Sachi Mata, was the daughter of Nilambar Chakravarti. Nilambar Chakravarti's family deity is Madan Gopal. And that same deity is there in the village of Belpakor. Belpakor, in the times of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, was full of many Brahmins. It was a very aristocratic and very wealthy village. When we go there nowadays, it appears almost deserted, not much there. There are some big houses which are neglected, run down, because many of the people from that village have become, you know, they've all gone to the cities. They've moved to Delhi and Bombay and Calcutta. They have their home, their family home there, but hardly ever they go there. Sometimes you may experience like that. I was in Calcutta airport one time, I remember. We met the one official there, quite a big official in the airport, and he was talking to us, and he said, "Where have you been?" And I told him, "We went to Mayapur." He said, "Oh yes." He said, "We have our family home in Swarup Ganj." You know, we were in Swarup Ganj the other night. He said, "Yeah, I've never been there for years, but our family home is there." So this is the same, this is the kind of situation with Belpakor. Tomorrow night we'll have our camp there. When we get there, you will go to see the deity of Madan Gopal, which is a very old deity, and it's been worshipped by Nilambar Chakravarti and all of his family for many, many generations. And it's still being worshipped in that way. The devotee who lives there, who does the puja, is now he's an initiated disciple of Srila Jaipataka Swami Maharaj. So he's initiated in ISKCON. They continue to do the puja, and our society helped them to maintain the temple. So this is all part of the work. As we go around the Mayapur Dham, Navadvip Dham, we can see how much the Bhaktivedanta Charity Trust is doing. That they're performing very nice, important service to help to maintain these different temples and these holy places. So this is all due to Srila Prabhupada's work through his ISKCON society. Before Srila Prabhupada left the world, he requested the devotees to make this trust, the Bhaktivedanta Charity Trust, and help the different temples in the Holy Dham to maintain them and to develop them. This year, when I went to Eka Chakra, I saw that they're rebuilding the temple. The deity found by Lord Nityananda, Bankim Rai, the famous deity there in Eka Chakra. So that temple, there was a big temple there, but it was in very poor repair. So now Bhaktivedanta Charity Trust have donated money there, and they're rebuilding it. So you can see that how the Charity Trust is performing many nice services, helping to maintain and to develop the Holy Dham. So tomorrow we'll go to Belpakor, and then after that, then the next night we'll be back in Jagannath Mandir for the last night. Okay, so thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki. Navadvip Dham Parikram ki. Gaur Premanande.
Chankasi Samadhi. The Chankasi tomb, there are two trees. One is the Champak tree, one is the Nim tree. Lord, and they praise Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and the Champaka train is for the Chankas. So it shows the intimate connection between the two. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu began the Sankirtan movement, it was not very much appreciated. The smarter Brahmins did not appreciate it. And of course the people who were not Hindus, they also did not appreciate it. The Mohammedan people, they were ruling at the time. The governor was Mohammedan. Jankazi was ruler. So Jankazi wanted to stop the Sankirtan movement. Just simply a disturbance. Just like people challenged Srila Prabhupada. When Prabhupada began the Sankirtan movement, even in India, people were opposing. There was a newspaper in Bombay, they said the Sankirtan was a nuisance, was disturbing people. So when Srila Prabhupada got the news, he said, send more devotees, increase the Sankirtan. In Australia, the devotees were distributing books.
Don't make a court case, yeah. So devotees sometimes would be put in jail. They would spend like a week in jail sometimes because they were doing Sankirtan. So when Prabhupada came there, the reporters, they said, your movement is not receiving much support from the authorities here. Prabhupada said, at least they have not crucified any of our devotees. So Srila Prabhupada understood that establishing Sankirtan is always will meet with opposition. And Prabhupada said, that is it, that is proof of the authenticity of the Sankirtan movement. That when the demonic people oppose it, then we can understand that it is having real power. So similarly, 500 years ago, here in Mayapur, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was having Sankirtan, nocturnal kirtan, in the home of Srivas Thakur. Tomorrow we will visit Srivas Angam. We will see the place where Lord Chaitanya began the Sankirtan movement. So when the Chankazi heard about this, he was not happy. He did not want that the Hindu people would increase, and he did not want that their movement would... Chankazi tried to restrict the Sankirtan movement. And in fact, he came with the soldiers and they broke a madanga drum. They smashed the madanga and ordered all the devotees, if this continues, you'll be arrested. You'll all be thrown in jail. Of course, in those days, it was not difficult to convert someone to Muslim. Just thinking about the pastime, Subhuti Rai. Subhuti Rai had a servant, and the servant did something wrong, so Subhuti Rai punished him. He caned him. And he left a mark on the body of the boy he caned. Later on, that young boy grew up to become a ruler. And his wife noticed that he had this mark on him. So she asked him, where did this mark come from? So he said, oh, when I was a boy, I was serving this Subhuti Rai, and I did something wrong, he caned me. So she said, this is terrible. You have to take revenge from him. You have to do something about him. You cannot allow that to be left untouched. You have to get some revenge on him. So at first the Mohammedan boy said, well, it was my fault. I did something wrong. And actually Subhuti Rai, he's a good person. He was a good master, it was my fault, But his wife insisted, no, you have to do something. So he said, all right, I will make him a Mohammedan. And in those days, simply if a Muslim poured water on someone, then they would become a Mohammedan. So this Mohammedan man went and poured water on Suburi Rai and said, now you're a Mohammedan. You've lost your Hindu caste. So Suburi Rai went to the Brahmins and he asked them, what can I do? They told him, the only thing you can do is drink boiling ghee. Boiling ghee, to drink boiling ghee is to kill yourself, to commit suicide. So Suburi Rai was not very eager to do that. But then he heard that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had come and he went to meet Lord Chaitanya. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told him, you don't have to drink boiling ghee. You simply have to chant the holy names of Krishna and serve the Vaishnavas. If you do these things, then you will be atoned from any sinful activity. So Suburi Rai was very happy to hear this, and he began chanting the holy name. He went to Vrindavan, and he served all the Vaishnavas. So my point is, in those days, it was very easy for somebody who was a Hindu to be made into a Mohammedan. So the Chankasi was threatening all the devotees that if you don't stop this kirtan, we'll put you in prison and you'll be forced to become Muslims like this. So he'd broken the madanga and he threatened the Vaishnavas with imprisonment. So it was at that time then Lord Chaitanya organized the devotees. So maybe Gopal Krishna Maharaj would like to continue. Speak more. Seventh day of Parikrama tomorrow. It's like the half, just a half a day. There will be a lot of Parikramas all meeting together. Union of all the Parikrams and other temples, Gaudiya Mats and so on, they'll also be performing Sankirtan. So it's quite a hectic day. Today's kind of like the final day. Reflecting on the Parikrama, I remember going on the first Parikrama, when was it, 1980s? The first one? Yeah, somewhere in 1980s. That time, the first time we stayed out, that was 89, okay. So that time, you know, Tamal Krishna Goswami, Shivaram Swami, Sankarshan Das Adhikari, many devotees. Well, we were all camping out. And you can see over the years how the Parikrama has developed now. You know, we have this year, last year there was a bigger Parikrama. There were 10,000 devotees on Parikrama last year. This year is down to about 6,000 or more. The Russian Parikrama went down a bit because of the Russian economy. But still, it's increased so much. This year we had a new camp. Last year also there was a new camp, a new land purchased. So there's many things we have to do, many things which we want to do, which Srila Jayapataka Maharaj and the other managers would like to do to develop this Parikrama. And it requires all of our cooperation. A few days ago, we distributed pamphlets talking about the Navadvip Dham Parikrama Development Fund. And we're requesting all the devotees, those of you who are able, who are financially able, that you can contribute towards this fund. It helps so much to improve the facilities for all of the devotees coming on Parikrama in the future. As we heard, Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, we'll conquer the world by Parikrama. The whole world will be benefited. So we want to see that this Parikrama will go on and it will continue to develop and expand nicely. So many things to be done. We need all of you to support, to contribute to this. Bhakti Nityananda Swami Maharaj is one of the committee members, right, on the trust here. And Jaipataka Swami Maharaj, he maintains three temples in the Parikrama. He personally supports them. So we're looking for all of you that you can also give your support, that you can contribute to this, that we can continue to develop this Parikrama. There are many things to be done. If we don't secure properties, then the chances are that these properties will fall into the hands of materialistic non-devotees. And in the future, we may be denied access to these places. You get things like brick factories and chicken farms, pig farms, making it very inconvenient for us to come there and to have our kathas. So it's very important that we are able to develop the Parikrama, and it means providing, looking for proper lands, and then once we secure the right land, then developing it, putting on some nice facilities so that we can have reasonably sanitary bathing facilities and tents and so on, accommodation. All of these things help to make it easier for people on Parikrama. So we count on all of you to give your support if you are able. Maharaj, would you like to say something in this regard?
This place is Panchavaktra Shivatala, and it's in the island of Simantadweep. Simantadweep means where the process of hearing is particularly emphasized. Simantadweep is actually the island we should have visited in the very beginning of our Parikrama, but because there are so many groups, it's not possible that we could perform the Parikrama in the exact order. So we've come to Simantadweep at the end of our Parikrama. Yesterday we were in Rudradweep. We only visited one place in Rudradweep. That was Shankarpur. And we spoke about Shankaracharya, but we did not speak about the process of devotional service which is practiced in Rudradweep. And that was Sakyam, our friendship. So I asked Mohan Rupa Prabhu, so we'll have Mohan Rupa Prabhu, the temple president from Delhi, speak to us about the process of Sakyam. And then we'll hear something more about Lord Shiva. Mahavishnu Swami is going to speak something.
Establishing the Krishna consciousness movement showed all of us the perfect example. Prabhupada taught us how to preach Krishna consciousness, and he taught us also how to leave the world. His example in leaving this world was also very exemplary. How he gave away everything. He said, I came with nothing, I want to leave with nothing. He passed over everything. And from the very beginning of our society, he set up a management structure so that the ISKCON society could continue. And that, of course, was in the formation of the governing body commission. Srila Prabhupada wanted that some senior devotees would take the responsibility to make sure the movement would continue. Srila Prabhupada was concerned for others. He was not concerned for his own self, but he was concerned in how he could give a better life for others. So my appreciation for Srila Prabhupada was his wonderful example in many simple ways. I remember particularly one time he came, one time we were living in a very small center in London. It was the number 7 Bury Place, and we had one room there for Srila Prabhupada, and there was an attached toilet for Srila Prabhupada. And then one devotee came from Los Angeles, and he saw the center, and he saw the room which we had for Srila Prabhupada. And then he wrote to Srila Prabhupada and said, "Prabhupada, I don't think this room is good enough for you." He said, "When you come," he said, "we will rent you a room in a hotel." He said, "and then the devotees could make use of your room also, because we have a lot of devotees and we don't have much facility for them, but if we rent a room in a hotel for you, then they can use your room." But Srila Prabhupada said, "No, I don't want to stay in any hotel. I like to stay in the temple with devotees." So I really appreciated that mood of Srila Prabhupada, that he was in the mood of being with the devotees, not separate from the devotees. He didn't really make himself different from others. He liked to be with the devotees, and he liked to constantly guide us and instruct us. Okay, so you can read more about our appreciation, my appreciation. If you look in the Vyasa Puja books, every year we write our Vyasa Puja offering to Srila Prabhupada. Another question, what does maturity in Krishna consciousness mean? Well, there are different stages of advancement in Krishna consciousness. The process of devotional service is described as beginning with faith, adoshrada tata sadhu sangha. With faith, then we associate with devotees. Like you come on parikrama and you get the association of devotees. You have a bit more faith. Your faith increases. You want to be with the devotees and associate with them. And then in the association of devotees, you learn bhajana kriya. We learn how to perform devotional service. We begin to chant. We begin to go to the aarti and take part in the different activities of the devotees. And after, along with bhajana kriya, then at that time there is also initiation. So this is maturing in Krishna consciousness, where you accept initiation. You become initiated by a bona fide spiritual master, and then you go on to practice devotional service, and through devotional service we remove the anarthas, or the unwanted things within the heart. Artha means what we want, what we desire, and anartha means what we don't want. Things like lust, anger, and greed, illusion, madness, envy, these kind of things should be removed from the heart. And as we mature in Krishna consciousness, then we become steady, we come to the stage of nishtha, very fixed in our practice of devotional service. Even though we may not be in good health, we still want to chant our rounds, we still want to hear about Krishna, we still like to take part in the activities of devotional service. And then we get ruchi, we develop the higher taste, a very strong attraction for the different activities of devotional service. The kirtan may not be very melodious or very sweet, but it's kirtan, and we're happy to hear that. That is ruchi. The deity worship may not be elaborate, it may just simply be some pictures, but we become pleased, we become joyful, simply seeing devotee worship, some photographs. This is ruchi. And then asakti, where we become fully attached to Krishna. We have no interest practically in anything mundane. And asakti, then next stage is bhava, where we develop ecstatic love for Krishna. And bhava is the seed of prema, or pure love of God. So this is maturing in Krishna consciousness. Okay, I think we don't want any more questions, you know, because today's the last night, and I think Jaipataka Maharaj is going to come after Arti. But anyway, I'm just trying to round off here some of the things, try to satisfy devotees. Srimad Bhagavatam gives the analogy of the captain and the ship. Could you kindly explain the necessity of both? The captain means the spiritual master. The ship is the human form of life. The necessity of both. Well, yes, the human form of life is very valuable, because in the human form of life, we can inquire. Vedanta Sutra says, Atato Brahma Jignasa, that now, meaning now you're in the human form of life, now you can begin to inquire about what is matter and what is spirit. That is the beginning of human life, when we begin to inquire. And when we are actually serious to understand the nature of life, then we will approach a spiritual master. In other words, the captain of the ship. So yes, these things are very essential. How to maintain good relationship between devotees? We have the example in Nectar of Instruction. Prabhu, no more. Sorry. I've already got more than enough here. In the Nectar of Instruction, it says there are six ways we can have loving relationships: offering gifts in charity and accepting charitable gifts, inquiring confidentially, revealing one's mind in confidence, offering prasadam and accepting prasadam. These are six symptoms of love shared between one devotee and another. If you want to have good relationships with devotees, then practice some of these loving relationships. It's not very difficult. Take up the bucket of prasadam and go and serve the devotees. Devotees will be happy, right? You come and serve. Be eager to give service and not to be served. That should be the mood. If we have that mood of being the servant, then we will be sure to have nice relationships with the devotees. How to overcome our sense gratification mentally? Simply by chanting Hare Krishna and keeping ourselves busy in the service of Krishna. We explained this previously. Devotees should be sensitive or not? We should be sensitive about being engaged in Krishna service. We don't want to be sensitive in the sense that we're more bodily conscious. If we're disturbed that somebody criticizes us, just like we heard, you know, somebody's black and they come and they say to Prabhupada, Prabhupada, they're discriminating against me because I am black. Prabhupada said, that is their problem. Why are you worried about it? Right? So somebody criticizes us, you know, don't be sensitive about it. Don't be bodily conscious. We have to understand we're not the body. They may be in disease condition. It doesn't mean we should be in disease condition. If he is an authoritative position in the temple president or manager, what is the limit of being sensitive while dealing with others, especially while dealing with devotees? Well, temple managers, temple presidents, they are representatives of the spiritual master. They have to be sensitive to the devotees. They should have the mood, they want to encourage the devotees. You don't want to be too much heavy or too critical, overly critical of a devotee. If somebody's a manager or temple president, it's a stressing position. It's a difficult job. And we have to understand that they're probably under some stress. They're probably worried maybe about different financial commitments which the temple has and different other responsibilities which they have as the temple president or manager. Responsibilities like maintaining the deity worship and looking after the devotees and looking after the temple property. These are quite stressing responsibilities. We should appreciate that it's not easy for somebody to be in charge, to be the temple manager and temple president. And we have to also be tolerant. If they're heavy on us, if they're critical of us, we should accept it. As Krishna's mercy, Lord Chaitanya teaches us to be tolerant like the tree. Don't be overly disturbed by it, but take it as the mercy of Krishna. Being conditioned at current level of practice, what can be practical application of verse 247? Well, that was covered last night, right? I remember hearing Kavi Chandra speak on this last night. 247 was Karmani Eva Dikariste. Right? You have a right to do your duty. On Ekadasi, we feel spiritually surcharged due to not eating grains. I am inspired to have a non-grain diet to improve my quality of chanting. So if my body allows, shall I stop eating grains? Well, it's up to you. If your body allows, if your cook allows. Are you cooking for yourself or not? If you're cooking for yourself, then it's not a problem. You know, some people take non-grain diet and they simply eat, you know, some fruits or some dry food stuffs. You have to consider how practical it is for you. It shouldn't, however, minimize your service. Rather, it should increase your ability to do service. In the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna has stated, Anad Bhavati Bhutani Parjanyad Anasambhava, that all living entities subsist on food grains. So Srila Prabhupada, one time devotees were just eating fruit or something, and Prabhupada said, well, I'm eating grains. He said, I don't know why they're not eating. So if you feel you can improve your service, you can do it. But you have to be practical. You can't expect to have the temple all orientated around your diet, just to suit your diet. How can we develop real appreciation for the holy dust of Navadvip? Well, that's why we're here on Parikrama. We hope that by coming on Parikrama and hearing about the glories of the different places, the different pastimes which took place, then we will develop more appreciation for the holy dust here. We will not see it as material. We have to see the holy dham with spiritual vision. A conditioned soul sees with their eyes. The dog sees with his nose. Devotee has to see through the eye of knowledge, with the eye of scripture. That is spiritual vision. So by hearing from the scriptures about the different pastimes which have taken place in the holy dham, we develop more appreciation. Okay. Hare Krishna. While walking on the Parikrama, I am attracted to the beautiful Vaishnavas walking alongside. Kindly explain how to see them as mothers. Hare Krishna. Please also tell how to remain absorbed in Krishna consciousness when or while. How to remain absorbed in Krishna consciousness while legs are paining and body is tired during parikram. Well, get absorbed in the kirtan. All right? When the kirtan is going on, then you'll transcend the body. We have to change the consciousness. Instead of being conscious of the pains and aches in the body, become absorbed in the sound of the holy name. So I encourage all the devotees, when you're walking like that, try to stay near the kirtan. What, so long as you can hear the kirtan, then you'll transcend all of these things. When you get in the kirtan, we hope you don't notice all the beautiful mothers, right? You can forget about them, get jumping and dancing and chanting, and then you forget about all of these bodily attractions and bodily miseries. So this is the power of Krishna consciousness, right? Vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehina rasovarjam rasopyasya param drisvanivartate. The embodied soul may be restricted from sense enjoyment, but the taste for sense objects remains. But ceasing such pleasure by experiencing a higher taste, he's fixed in consciousness. So that's the idea. You can become fixed in consciousness through the chanting of the holy name. Get the higher taste. Many new people come usually in our temple. They are attracted by Krishna consciousness, but after some time, most of the people leave our movement. Usually it is saying that Maya catch them because they have association with non-devotees. Or on the opposite side, how to help these people not to be attracted by Maya? What we can do? We can give good association to them. Simply try to attract them to Krishna consciousness. Become their friend. Make friends with them. If you can become their friend in a Krishna conscious manner, then that can mean so much to people. Bringing people to Krishna consciousness and getting them to stay in Krishna consciousness requires some effort on our part. That we have to make friends with these people and make them feel wanted. Make them feel like they belong in the Krishna consciousness movement. If they have that feeling of belonging and feeling of being wanted, then they'll never go away from Krishna consciousness. And so we have to help them to develop that kind of appreciation for the Krishna consciousness movement. This is all part of devotee care. New people coming, somebody's not very strong in Krishna consciousness, they have some problems, they need help. So help them, become their friend, go and cook some prasadam with them, read together with them, associate with them more, listen to their problems, what doubts they have, and try to help them. I'm trying to maintain 4 regulative principles, chanting 16 rounds every day, associating with devotees, doing every day Mangal Aarti, deity worship, but unable to maintain Mahaprabhu's third Shikshastikam sloka, which is key, which is very important to grow in devotional service. Okay, so the third verse, that in other words, we should offer all respects to others and we should not be anxious for respect for ourselves. So how can we cultivate that? That it's not just only doing the activities of devotional service, but we have to cultivate this mood of Trinadapi Suni Chena, right? We want to be humble, tolerant, offer respect to others and not be anxious for respect ourselves. How can we do this? Well, by regularly reciting this verse, by repeating it again and again, and by meditating on it, by thinking about deeply, how can I do this? How can I become more tolerant? What do I need to do to be more humble? How can I offer respects? How can I get rid of this desire to be honored by others? Just simply keeping that verse on our tongue. As it is said, we're supposed to put it on a thread and wear it around our neck for constant remembrance. So if we're constantly remembering this verse and thinking about how we can apply these principles, then gradually it will happen that we will change. This is how we can do it. We're doing the activities of devotional service, and by meditating on this verse, then gradually our consciousness will also become purified. How do we understand if we constantly under confusion what to do? How to understand if we're constantly confused what to do? Well, what to do? We should take shelter of a senior Vaishnava, somebody who is not confused. You have to be guided. You have to take guidance from somebody, a superior authority. You have to read more. You have to do more hearing and chanting. Confusion is coming due to the mind. The mental condition is to be confused. We have to fix the mind in hearing and chanting, and then that confusion will be forgotten. So confusion may be about services according to the spiritual master's desire. Well, take clear instruction from the spiritual master. There's no need to be confused. Just go and find out exactly what the spiritual master desires. Or there may be some confusion according to our own desires, our intentions, not to develop new. Why is Ritu Dweep under Sakyam? when Lord Shiva is greatest servant and not a friend. Yeah, no, this question was answered yesterday. You gave me these questions, you said they weren't answered, but I heard these answered yesterday. Kavi Chandra Maharaj explained clearly, Lord Shiva is a friend of Krishna. Lord Krishna gave Lord Shiva benediction that his temples would be more than Krishna's. Krishna takes pleasure in seeing his devotee worship. And that's why the worship of Lord Shiva is so prominent here in the Dham. It's for the pleasure of Lord Krishna. Yeah, these questions have been answered. I've heard this. Yeah, these questions have all been answered. Okay, Manaji gave one question. Oh my goodness. Try to read it here. Is it Yoga Maya that makes Lord Chaitanya forget that he is Krishna? So that we can relish the ecstasy of separation from Krishna. Oh, so that he can relish the ecstasy of separation from Krishna. Even though he is Krishna himself. Is it Yoga Maya you're asking? Well, it is Krishna's own desire. Yeah, we could say this is also Yoga Maya. Usually Yoga Maya acts on the devotee. Yoga Maya doesn't act on Krishna. It's under Krishna's control. Yoga Maya acts on us, usually in the form of Maha Maya. We become influenced by the effect of the Lord's energy. But the Lord's energy, like Yoga Maya, is under his control. It's not independent. So it's not that Yoga Maya is forcing Krishna to forget. But if Krishna wants to, he can forget and he can take the mood of his devotee. The Lord is independent and he can act as he pleases. Krishna ordered Lord Shiva to speak Mayavadi philosophy as Shankaracharya. Did he order the Prophet Muhammad and Jesus Christ? What is the connection between the Supreme Personality of Godhead and the other religious leaders? Everything is under the control of Krishna. I have a torch, I have this. So when Prophet Muhammad or Lord Jesus Christ act, they're also empowered. They have some Shakti, all right? Shaktavesha avatars. They're empowered because they can lead so many people. they can give them a better life, teaching some religious process to elevate society. So yes, Prophet Muhammad, Lord Jesus Christ, they also do great work for the benefit of the world, to bring people to a more civilized level of existence, understanding that there is God, there is a supreme being, and we are meant to serve him. We see how the Mohammedan people offer prayers every day, 5 times a day. They have their scriptures, the Quran. In the same way, the Christian people also have great faith and love for Lord Jesus Christ and how he sacrificed his life for others. So in our Krishna consciousness movement, we are not against other religious processes, and they are all authorized by the Lord. In different places of the world, in different cultures, the Lord empowers individuals to do this kind of preaching work. So they're all teaching the message of God, to love God, to be the servant of God. Christianity and Islam, they're also teaching to love God, to serve God. But we say that we get the greatest knowledge, the greatest information through the Vedic teachings. So we do have respect for other traditions. It's not that we say we are the only way. No, we have faith in our particular process, but we do recognize that there are other types of religious processes. I feel much better in Brajadham. I have many Krishna conscious realizations of Leela in Brajadham. But at the present moment, I am living in Sri Mayapur Dham and have done few Navadvip Mandal Parikrams, but have very few realizations of Leela, etc., which are not very strong. What I should do? Well, generally, we should begin in Navadvip Dham and then go to Braja. Braja is for more advanced devotees. If you're not having much realization here, you need to continue to do the parikrama here and develop some realization. At least we should develop strong attachment for Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Because by serving Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that is how we can best understand Radha and Krishna. We're not encouraged to try to understand Radha and Krishna without going through Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his devotees. Rupa Raghunathapadi Hai Beakuti Kabehamase Yugala Priti. If you want to understand the pastimes of Radha and Krishna, you have to go through the Goswamis. And the Goswamis are followers of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So we have to properly understand Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes here. And then we can go on to understand Radha and Krishna. Mayapur Dham, Navadvip Dham, Mandal is very merciful. We heard that Lord Chaitanya is the incarnation of the Lord in his most merciful form. And this Dham is also supremely merciful. That it, you cannot, you don't get much offenses here. But if you do a little service here, you get so many times the benefit. Even when you lay down at night to take rest, you get the benefit of offering obeisances. And everything you eat in the Dham is like prasadam. So chanting, everything done here in the Holy Dham is very powerful. This is a particular benefit of being here in Mayapur Dham. You should take advantage. And then you can better go on to appreciate Braja. Don't think you're wasting your time here in Mayapur, but rather it will give you a stronger foundation when you go back to Vrindavan.